Okay. So, welcome to Q&A with Doc.
If this is the speed of the iPhone 4S on AT&T, what is 4G speed on T-Mobile?
Oh, it's my silly Ustream. Hello, silly Ustream. How are you guys doing today? Sorry I don't have my hands-free device. So we might have some background noise. I think I left it, might have been in my bedroom. I was talking with my mom the other day, and I think I just left it there. Go ahead and feel free to chat with us. I've got my chat up on Facebook. Otherwise, if you go in on Ustream, you can go to the, see if I can pop that back out here. Last time Sam told me that there was an easier way to figure this out. If you go to pop out chat, which I think I've already done, and then type in the little box down here, you say, hello, Ustream audience. We got a little bit of a delay too because I think I'm running off of my phone's modem. Yay, tethering. Three topics tonight we're going to be covering. The first one is twins with flat heads. I had a couple interesting cases over the last week of babies who had something that's diagnosed with as plagiocephaly. It means that you have, instead of having a nice round head, you've got one side that's flat. And there was a family who had given birth to twins, non-English speaking, so I don't know how they got the information that you take twin babies and lay them facing each other, but they did. And so twins had flat heads on opposite sides, like, you know, if the right one was this way, the left one was the other way. Made it easier to tell them apart, but certainly not the preferred method of doing that. I also had someone that I was answering a question for on Southwest Florida Moms about, I don't know if it was a pediatrician who recommended that she get a helmet or a CT for her child's head, but it brought up an interesting conversation about how much movement you can get with cranial bones in infants, and also why that's even important. Because one of the issues is you look at the baby and obviously you can tell there's asymmetry there, but some people say, hey, everybody has a little asymmetry. What's the big deal with that? Isn't it just a cosmetic thing? Well, the way that the body works, especially neurologically, is that structure and function are related to each other. And if you have depression on one side with neurology, something like the brain, that's going to interfere with how that grows and develops, especially at such a huge time for growth and development, like the first year of life. One of the things that we can do as chiropractors, and I know craniosacral therapists really focus in on this, is we actually will adjust and move 70% of the central nervous system that surrounds the brain, that area that surrounds the brain. And the reason that we can do that is if you've ever looked at a skull really closely, you see that we're not a great big cue ball. We don't have just one big shiny, you know, white, completely smooth mass up there. We have all these little Z's that come around in specific places along your head, and those are called suture lines. They're joints that are meant to allow your brain to be able to push back up against the skull and allow those skull bones to move. They interlock like this, and then they wiggle back and forth really subtly. The bigger purpose for that is on the inside of your brain, you have these holes. They're called ventricles. And they're lined with this tissue called chorionic villi. The chorionic villi produce a chemical a lubricating fluid that's called cerebral spinal fluid. Now, you've all heard of CSF. It's the stuff that, and if you see a movie, somebody has a head injury and they get that kind of that weird looking fluid that leaks out of their nose or out of their ears, and you're like, ooh, this is a bad sign, right? Or if someone has, they suspect meningitis and they're gonna do a spinal tap. Or for moms who've had epidurals, that's what they're actually puncturing the dura to put the medication in, is that cerebral spinal fluid. CSF has some pretty important functions. One is, we all know that the nerve system is electrical. It sends electric impulses from your brain down through all your nerves. That CSF actually helps the conducting of the electricity. Second thing that CSF does, it helps nourish the neurons, and it also helps work as a shock absorber. So if you get hit in the head, it works as a way to keep your brain from bashing up against the side of your skull. So that's those are the three major functions for CSF. And it doesn't have a pump like our heart will pump our blood. What our body relies on is our breathing reflex. Do me a favor while I've been talking here the last couple minutes, about 5 minutes, is anybody hear me okay? Send me a message if you're having any problems with hearing me. Not getting any pop-ups? Okay. One of the things that will happen with cerebral spinal fluid is it can get kind of stagnant in an area and not flow very well. Thank you very much. Appreciate that, Carly. If the brain structures aren't moving properly every time you breathe, then that can cause some problems with the movement of the cerebral spinal fluid. It can cause problems with the conducting of the electrical impulses, and it can also impact how the brain starts to develop. One of the things that I'll measure with every single one of my babies that comes into the office is I'll measure from this bump. If you go ahead and feel the back of your head, you have this bump back there. If you play Words with Friends or Scrabble, get out a pen because it's like a triple word score. It's the external occipital protuberance. We call it the EOP for short. And I'll take a tape measure and I'll measure from there all the way to the front part right here in between the eyebrows on one side, and then I'll compare it to the measurement on the other side, and I'll measure all the way around to make sure that my measurement's even. What I'll find most times is that babies will have one side that's larger than the other. And what's happened is that you have a little bit of a bowing, a little bit of an overlap on the larger side. When we adjust that larger side, that suture line, it's a really easy, just a pole adjustment, and I'll use a drop piece that I wear around my neck, and I'll put it against my chest, and it just goes like that, just a small little movement like this. So the adjustment is about 4 ounces of pressure. To feel what that feels like on you, if you take your thumb and you push with the pressure you can stand on your eyeballs, if you have a tomato handy and you push just before, a really ripe tomato, before you go through that skin, that's about 4 ounces of pressure. And I'll go the bottom of the suture, the middle part of the suture, and the top part of the suture. And then I'll have parents at home do a really simple exercise. It's called inversion. Every time you breathe, it's supposed to allow the skull to expand and contract really subtly. It's supposed to allow the tailbone to move back and forth. With kids who have cranial overlap like that, they're not getting that pump, so we have to do something that's called cranial blowout. I'm adjusting and stimulating that suture. What they do is they bring their child upside down, really only for about 20 seconds to 30 seconds, to allow gravity to bring that cerebral spinal fluid back down into the head to help with the expansion and to help with the rhythm. It's really amazing how well this works. I've been doing this with children, almost 2 years now. And without fail, now again, these are with kids who are less than a year old. In the span of about 3 months' time, we can get those numbers from like a 2 centimeter difference is a pretty big difference. We get it back to even in about 90 days. Now that's with the parents being able to bring that child upside down. The more interesting part with it is with kids that are a little bit older. I've had now 3 kids in my practice that we started working with those suture lines because they had a little bit of a language delay. They weren't quite verbal yet, and they were getting around that age where they should be stringing together 2-word combinations and 3-word combinations. The most amazing thing happened right around that 3 months of being able to do that on a regular basis, usually 2 or 3 times a week. Obviously, you can't bring a kid upside down for 2, they're kind of heavy. And plus, the sutures are growing together more. But we started seeing those children start to string together 2- and 3-word combinations. A side effect about a kid that I had in the office, named Amit. Amit would have little bits of fits. Like the way that he would express to his mom that he was unhappy about something is that he would drop down onto his butt. He'd do that all the time. If he was upset, he didn't want to do something, he wouldn't say no. He would drop down on his butt and he'd throw a fit. And after about 3 weeks of working with Amit, he started saying no. And his little sister, who's I think Sophie's around 6 or 7, said that no was Amit's favorite word. I thought it was really interesting how we had this child who was like trying to physically express that behavior, to try to control his environment because he couldn't verbalize it. And that his first word after working with him was no. He was able to verbalize that. And I asked his mom, I said, have you noticed that he stopped doing the dropping on the butt thing? She said, yeah, he doesn't do that so often. So it's a case study that I'm writing up. Let's see if we can put it out and publish it. But we need more more evidence, we need more cases to be able to demonstrate that this is something that works universally. But in these cases, for sure, I'm starting to see that work. Very interested with kids on the spectrum, if we can catch them early enough, still working with those coronal sutures, especially the ones, the coronal suture here on the sides, if we can impact speech and language development. When I heard about the adjustments for that, it was a chiropractor who was talking about teenagers and speech pathology, things like stutters and stammers, children with dyslexia. He was also advocating at that age not only doing that kind of suture work. He said, listen, when they're older, it's going to take longer because you have more mature bone to work with. But between that and doing cross-crawl therapy, he was seeing really interesting changes in children's ability to get through some of those developmental issues. In fact, he said that so his daughter wouldn't feel strange about crawling around, you know, she's 16, but so she wouldn't feel so awkward about it, the whole family would spend 10 to 15 minutes every day just kind of crawling on all fours. And he said he noticed some interesting things in his behavior and in his wife's behavior. You know how, like, sometimes you might transpose your numbers, like you're writing out your checks, and instead of writing a check out for $56, you accidentally write it out for $65. Or you're typing something into a calculator and you switch numbers backwards. It's something that I do.
First letters of words.
Yeah, good point. He said that was something that he noticed that he would do every once in a while. But when he was doing the cross-crawling, that didn't happen so much. His wife said that she would do crossword puzzles. And you know how, like, you're trying to think of a word, but it's right there. You're like, man, I know all the other ones. I just can't come up with the right word for this phrase. He said that she noticed that she was getting better at that language recall when she was doing the cross-crawl therapy. So a couple interesting things going on in these speech and language centers right here on the side that show that it may not just be a cosmetic effect. If babies have that plagiocephaly, it might actually impact your brain's ability to access those things. So that was a pretty interesting thing I thought came out of this week. I'm going to see, this mom said that she'd send me the MRI of her child because there can be some other pathological reasons for having head asymmetry. The first one, you can have problems with the brain on the inside, that the brain doesn't actually form, or those ventricles get too big, or they're producing too much fluid for whatever reason, and so we're missing part of the brain, and so the body's compensation mechanism for that is a bulging. But you recognize those kids right away. If they're missing part of their brain, then they have some severe neurological problems, and so those kids are pretty obvious. What's less obvious, and I think the reason why our pediatrician recommended the CT, is sometimes there can be problems with the bone growth itself, tumors inside the bone, or some sort of pathology inside the bone. So I told her, listen, without a problem, if you send me the radiology report, I'll go ahead and take a look at it, and I'll let you know what I think. So I'm interested to follow up with that on Wednesday. The second story that we had tonight, oxylates and autism. I had a patient of mine who, she was wondering if her kid was on the spectrum because he was having some language delays, and she has some history of dyslexia and ADHD and with her other children. And so based off some of the things she was reading, and he was having some, it seemed like sensory processing issues because he didn't seem to be hearing things. She was wondering if there were things that I should check out for. And she'd been doing some research about the GAPS diet, which is gut and psychological syndrome. And she'd been doing some reading on those forums. They started talking about oxalates, and that children who had kidney disorders or autism should steer away from them. And so she wanted my opinion on it. And I honestly didn't know a whole lot about oxalates at first. So I asked her to send me the resources she'd been reading. The oxalates are pretty much in everything that I recommend. They're in leafy green vegetables, they're in almonds, they're in nuts. And I was really curious as to why they were being discouraged for kids who might be on the spectrum. And it there was a study that they pointed to where they had children who were having kidney problems and problems with sensory processing issues, and when they removed the oxalates, they found that the children's behavior got better. The thing that I told Cindy about was, unless your child has some really obvious kidney function issues, and you can pick that up either with urine tests, some blood tests will show that, but it's mainly like urine tests, looking for proteins and that sort of thing. Unless your child has those kinds of things, I didn't really see a major evidence base to steer clear of oxalates. They're kind of phytochemicals that if your kidneys have a hard time processing certain minerals, can lead to things like kidney stones. And so if you have a history of kidney stones, you know, that's something that you see more and more often in, especially in the South, in kids. But typically those kids are also consuming a lot of sugars. Their diet's really crappy anyway. A lot of soda and that sort of thing. And that's not really how she was eating anyways. So my recommendation off on it, I'm open to reading more. In fact, I had a patient give me the GAPS diet book. I'm going to look into it more, but for now I'm going to say that the oxalates part, unless your children are showing signs of kidney disorders, probably shouldn't be the major focus. But it did bring up interesting points about, you know, gut syndromes. The GAPS diet is based off of a doctor's research in her clinic with hundreds of cases of developmental issues, things like kids who have coordination issues, problems with speech, sensory processing issues. They all were tied in with having some sort of gut disorder. She said asthma, eczema, and so me as a family chiropractor who really focuses on inflammation as being a component to allergy, a lot of the stuff to me was like, yeah, no duh. You eat garbage things that cause inflammation in your body, then that's going to start manifesting. Your body's going to have a need to push that out to wherever your area of susceptibility is. So she was having a conversation about, you know, if your children do have these kinds of symptoms, being able to nourish the gut is one way to help improve the neurological functioning of your kids. And, you know, honestly, we've known that since we were little, right? You are what you eat, yeah? And unfortunately, what we're eating nowadays, well, isn't that great for us? We have a heavy dairy focus in our society here.
Pieces of shit for breakfast. Sorry.
There's a big gluten. We talked about that on our two talks ago. That so much stuff is wheat-based in our society. A lot of high sugars, a lot of processed foods, a lot of food dyes. Eating real food is not that common, unfortunately. Being conscious of what kinds of grains are best for your body, being conscious of getting things like vegetables and good fruits is important, but...
That's not even to say what we put on our skin either.
Well, yeah, Erica says that it's the same what we put on our skin, but I mean, I'm not putting a ton of chemicals on babies, I'm going to say. The kids, I mean...
Not you, but...
I don't know. As a parent, are you putting a whole bunch of chemical on your kids for some reason? I don't... Yeah, there might be... Oh, you mean for like baby wipes and disinfectants and that kind of stuff?
Laundry.
Messing with the natural flora. I understand what you're saying. Yeah, our chemical load in this country is just crazy. Having an environment where we're getting rid of all the microorganisms isn't the healthiest. I understand not everybody can breastfeed, but if you're not going to, then probiotics are absolutely essential, because those are going to be something that helps train the gut, which helps train the immune system, which helps train the nerve system. I'm really interested to read more about the oxalates. Super interested to read this GAPS book, though. It's the second book on my list right now that I'm going to get to as soon as I finish the 5 Love Languages for Men. That Erica and I got back in, was it February? Yeah, we went to a seminar, and I still haven't done my homework, so, yeah. Oh, cool. Got a comment from Carly on that. Let's see here. I'm going to go ahead and read that for everybody. Carly says, I've read a couple articles from Susan Cossin-Owens today, author of this study. What's interesting to me on a personal level with my own child is that many of the foods on the low list are foods that I have added to his diet in recent years. I'm the sneaky mom chef, adding butternut squash to mac and cheese. By the way, the butternut mac and cheese, we did that. Amazing. So good. You don't even miss the dairy. Adding veggies to muffins, using almond or coconut milk instead of dairy milk whenever possible. And he's actually had a steady improvement from adding these things, as well as the fish oil supplement that was added a couple years ago. Part of the study suggested staying away from fish oils due to the fat absorption correlation. I don't even know what that means. I haven't gotten that part in the book yet. I would think, though, Carly's going to clarify for me. Thank you. We know that omega-3s are good for brains, and DHA and EPA are good for neurology. It may be one of those things, until I can see some different evidence for it, that I'm still gonna recommend. One of the questions, though, about fish oils is about other content. Now, what do we get? Nordic Naturals? Is that where we get our fish oil? The cod liver oil?
Norwegian something?
Yeah, I think it's Nordic. Carlson's. You Carlson's. Now, I'm weird. I like lemon fish oil. I like lemon cod liver oil. We tried the orange flavor yesterday, or the last couple weeks. Did not like that whatsoever. You can get different ones like Barleen's. You can sneak that into smoothies and whatnot. Kids shouldn't need... I don't know. I'm not a naturopath. I'm not going to sit there and tell you, doses for things.
That's
not my job. In general, I know people will... I'll tell short people they should get 1,000 milligrams, medium-sized people 1,500, and large people 2,000-3,000. So that's like 2-3 capsules a day. You'll know when you're getting enough, kind of based off what your skin's doing. Like, Erica gets oily when she takes as much fish oil as I do. I get scaly skin when I don't have enough. It's one of those things that you kind of have to monitor your kids. I mean, I suppose if you have rice paper and your kids will let you put rice paper on their face, you can do... We're making Halloween masks today. Yeah, right? Here we go. When your article stated you may want to avoid fish oils, if there's poor fat digestion, this may cause more absorption of oxalate. Oh, see, that's interesting. Try it with and without to see which is better. The vitamin D in some fish oils may be a problem for some children. So, that's one of those questions that I'm really interested in finding out more about. Because I would think that you would know if your kid's not absorbing the fish oil, also because they would have runny poo. Just like if you have, you remember the Olestra thing? The non-fat absorbing, it's popping up
cheese?
Here too.
Or I mean the
No,
chips.
It's the Pringles. Yeah.
The chips? Yeah.
It wouldn't absorb the fat, so it may cause the
diarrhea.
Green apple quick step. And this is actually not the first time we've talked about diarrhea on this Ustream. I think that makes maybe the third. So if that's a problem, again, monitor, see how your kid's doing with that. You really do get to experiment a little bit. The other thing that I was going to bring up about purity issues, there's some talk about krill oil maybe being more pure because it's lower on the food chain. I don't know. I know that there are certain companies that do test for purity for things like mercury or radioactivity. I mean, if that's a concern about Japan, you know, be a label reader. Be conscious of the supplements that you're bringing in. Don't do it blindly. Do some checking. There was one supplement manufacturer that I thought their stuff was the bee's knees because it was super tasty, and I checked, and their other lines had higher lead levels than was allowable by California standards, so they got sued. Carly linked an article. I'll go ahead and copy this and put it in the Ustream here. Let's see here. Oh, actually, I think my links are disabled here. I'm going to put on the Ustream chat, but what I'll do instead is post it on our page. Here we go. Okay. There was a note about children's response to the low oxalate diet. This is Carly. I think some of the temporary symptoms the children experience with increased aggression, rashes, behavior issues were along the lines of it gets worse before it gets better. I read something similar to that. That makes sense to me with regards to the immune system response. Get the oxalate out and reboot the system, so to speak, so what is then consumed can be used appropriately. Yeah, I think that's right. We see that a lot with kids that are doing a form of detox, that sometimes this stuff gets stuck into the cells and the body has to purge that, just like with a candida response. In fact, that's something that we see a lot of times with kids who are on the spectrum, is that they do have a tendency to get fungal infections a little bit more frequently. So, doing that kind of cleanse, you have what's called a die-off effect. And it makes me wonder if the oxalate is related then to candida functioning in the body. It's worth reading more about. It's an interesting topic. Kind of on that same vein of things that we thought were good for you or bad for you, making a judgment on that, and then later research proving it wrong. There is a study that just came out in the Journal of the New England Journal of Medicine or Journal of American Medical Association. I'm going to have to double check that really quick. That said that coffee drinking, which for about every doctor that you know will say, here, I'll get it. It's PubMed, New England Journal of Medicine. If you want to look for it, it's called Association of Coffee Drinking with Total and Cause-Specific Mortality. I'll put the reference up there on the Mama's Chiropractic Facebook page, too. Really interesting article. They looked at about 250,000 men, 170,000 women. Huge, huge study. And they did it from the late 90s until 2008. These were men and women who were between the age of 50 and their mid-70s. And they looked at all reasons that they died and lifestyle factors associated with that. Up until recently, we've always said that coffee drinking is associated with, higher rates of stroke and heart disease, accidents, all that kind of thing. But what Friedman et al. Did was they discovered, they looked at the data and said, well, it seems to me that coffee drinking might be more associated with smoking. And so when they started taking the smoking out and started controlling for that, they actually found that coffee drinking was related to living longer. That means that they said there was an inverse relationship. So that meant that the more coffee that you drank, the less likely you were to die from things like strokes and heart attacks, heart disease, all-cause mortality, with the exception of cancer. There wasn't a correlation between coffee drinking and cancer. But it said that if you drank one cup of coffee a day, that meant that you were just as likely as people who didn't drink any coffee at all to die from those things. If you drank two cups of coffee, you were less likely. If you drank three cups of coffee, you were even more less likely. This went all the way up to six cups of coffee a day. And this was alerted, I was alerted to this by another chiropractor who shares a very similar philosophy about inflammation than I do, about why that causes problems in the body. We know that coffee is an acidic chemical in the body. The caffeine causes acidity in the body. That means it causes inflammation, tears up the artery walls, causes global inflammation in your body. And it didn't make sense to us that something that as you brought more acid in, you would live longer. Also flew in the face of everything we've been saying about hydration. You can imagine drinking six cups of coffee every day, how chronically dehydrated you'd be. Your body's not made out of coffee, it's made out of water. And so the chemistry that your body works in is blowing us away about all the things that we've always said about both hydration and acidity levels in your body. That here these people were between the ages of 50 and 75, drinking up to six cups of coffee a day and outliving people who didn't drink any at all. Been working on this thing for a couple days now, trying to figure out any kind of correlation. And the only thing I can come up with, man, I'm right back to poop again. Maybe some sort of relationship between coffee drinking and eliminating toxins in your body. Or there might be something that's actually in coffee that helps as a, again, as some sort of phytochemical. Just the way that green tea helps your body. I'd be really interested to see if this study can be replicated with decaf drinkers, or people who drink Diet Coke, or people who drink green tea. Gosh, I'm sure there's Chinese studies on green tea and this kind of thing. But very, very interesting study that I'm looking for follow-ups on. If it has to do with elimination of toxins out of your body, it has to do with, you know, as we get older, it gets kind of harder to poop. Digestive systems don't work as well. It's one of the bigger complaints that I'll get in my family practice is that, you know, when their nervous system starts shutting down, the low back and the sacrum, bowel movement starts to decrease. And if you ask your grandparents, it's one of the things that they struggle with. It's making sure things are working well. So it's a reason why some people will drink coffee, is to help get, you know, their morning constitutional. If for some reason helping to drink coffee helps with that process, that would be one reason I would see why the body would be getting the inflammation out of the system, causing you to go to the bathroom more, both number one and number two. Both good ways for the parasympathetic nervous system to control level of inflammation in your body by eliminating it as waste. If coffee is one way to help with that, by all means, don't skip out on those espressos and lattes. I may be proven wrong by this later on. I'm reserving my judgment until later. But it goes to show, all things in moderation, even moderation. Except for, Dr. John Tickell used to say, the four things that you can have as much of as you want: laughter, sex, vegetables, and fish. And he used to say that if you're a nun and you don't do the sex thing, you could substitute rice for that, but it's much more messy and bad. Carly writes in to say that she read the NIH study as well. It wasn't clear to her as to the why, and same thing that we're saying too. One point that they made, the most studies compound is caffeine, although our findings were similar in those who reported the majority of their coffee intake, to be decaffeinated or caffeinated. All right, so I didn't read that in the abstract. I went to PubMed and read their abstract. And I didn't see that part, so that's interesting to me. So it may be something in the coffee bean itself, which means that you may be able to get that benefit. Now, decaffeinated is a little bit of a misnomer, because decaffeinated coffee does have caffeine in it. It's not necessarily caffeine free. Carly's putting in a message right now too.
What if coffee just makes your brain happy?
What if coffee just makes your brain happy?
It's fun to drink.
Because it's fun to drink and tastes good. It's an upper. Yeah? Yeah. I mean, yeah. I don't discount the feel-good element of it at all, but it's just something people like to do. Yeah? And doing the things that make you happy absolutely would help you live a much longer, happier life. Yeah? Good point. Carly's also given us the link. We'll put that up on within the thread too, and on Mama's Chiropractic page on Facebook. Looks like we're getting ready to wrap up here. Coming up to the 6:45. Thank you again for joining us. I've had a lot of fun. I want to thank Ada's. Yeah. The commercial for coffee just came on the break. That's funny. Thank you again. I want to thank Ada's Natural Market for helping to give us a place to do this. They gave us a shout out on their Facebook page earlier today, encouraging people to come check us out too. It allowed me to put the Ustream link up for people to come check us out. If you do have questions, again, go ahead and send them to me, John Doc Edwards, or post them to the Mama's Chiropractic page, and I'd be more than happy to answer them for you. That's where I get the material. Two things locally that are happening. Coming up next week, we're going to be doing our five talks with the doc, and that one is on authoritarianism versus humanism. What is your role in the doctor-patient relationship? When we start talking about what's your role, we give you tools that you can use to say, this is what I wanted in my healthcare situation. How do you find a provider who is willing to work with you as a partner instead of dictating what they think you ought to do? Why is it even important to start considering these kinds of questions when you're making healthcare decisions for your family? Also locally here at Fort Myers, we're doing our last Friday of the month at 6 p.m. Pathways Connect meeting. That Pathways Connect meeting coming up in June is going to be more of a dad's focus. For me and my dad, we have a different way that we choose for our lifestyles. We have different ways, probably the best job we can with the information that we have, but I may be making different choices with our kids than he made with me. Totally okay, that turned out fine, but it's just different values. So how do you address that with your parents? What kind of values do you want to instill in your kids, especially the society that our kids are going to grow up in, much different from the society that I grew up in. So how do we deal with those kinds of things too? So it's going to be more of a crunchy dad's kind of thing. Again, open to all backgrounds, all belief systems. We honor everybody's values here at Pathways Connect. Also open to both genders. If we have moms that want to join, please come. But I know that this issue of Pathways really is trying to make a push because Pathways is so both parents focused, really trying to make a highlight on that in June for Father's Day. So, yeah, let's see if we have any final thanks. Thank you, Carly, for participating. She sent us a thanks. And, we'll see you on the next Q&A with Doc coming up in 2 weeks. Until then. Gotta find my channel. You know what I'll get better at next time?
What?
Stopping recording.